My name is Bill Gouveia. I'm the town moderator for the town of Norton and a columnist for the Sun Chronicle, and it will be my honor and privilege to serve as the moderator of the debate here this evening. Norton Media Center is a nonprofit corporation run by the Norton Cable Access Commission. That commission is appointed in part by the selectmen and made up of people who work to bring you local and public programming here on your public access channels. The funds to operate this studio and bring you programming such as this come from a portion of your cable bill, which, according to Norton's cable contract with the provider, is designed to improve public access programming. The purpose of the debate this evening is to allow you, the citizens and voters, to hear directly from the candidates seeking to represent you. We hope you will use the information and insights you gain this evening as part of your decision-making process when you go to the polls on November 8th. This debate this evening is being produced and directed by Jason Benjamin, the studio manager of Norton Media Center. There are two candidates seeking to represent the 1st Bristol District, including the incumbent. Before I introduce our candidates, I would like to quickly review the rules for this evening, all of which have been agreed to by the candidates in advance. Each candidate will get no more than 3 minutes to make an opening statement. They will go in an order determined by coin flip, and in that process, I believe it's Mr. Toole who is going first.
That's correct.
Okay. For the opening, and then Mr. Barrows will go first, or go last in the closing statement. After opening statements, the candidates will be asked a question chosen by me. And the questions come from suggestions made by voters, which frankly, there weren't a lot, you know, viewers and myself. If you don't like the questions, you can pretty much blame me. I'm the one doing it. Each candidate will have no more than 3 minutes to answer the question, and all candidates will be asked the same question. After the last candidate has answered, the candidates will get no more than 1 minute for a rebuttal. After the last question, the candidates will be given no more than 3 minutes to make a closing statement. The time for each candidate will be kept here by me. It's not going to be to the second. When time is running out, I will make the candidates gently aware. If they do not end in time, it'll be my job to politely stop them to ensure fairness for all. And while we do encourage a vigorous and thorough debate of the issues, I will not allow personal attacks against any individuals, which I'm sure we're not going to have a problem with that here this evening. With all that said and done, let us move to the debate. It is now my pleasure to introduce our two candidates. First, to my far right, is the challenger, Mr. Michael Toole. And then to my immediate right is the incumbent and current state representative, Representative Jay Barrows. Thank you. Gentlemen, thank you again for joining us, and let's get right to it. We will start with our first opening statement, which comes from Mr. Toole.
Thank you. Mr. Moderator, Representative Barrows, the families of Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough, my name is Michael Toole, and I'm running to be your next state representative. Over the next hour, I hope to share a bit about myself, my priorities if elected as state representative. My family and I moved to Norton several years ago, and because of family. And over the past few years, we've made many friends and friendships, and basically have grown to love Norton and the natural beauty of Mansfield, Norton, and Foxborough. Kathy and I are raising two children that are publicly school educated here in Norton. My daughter Emma, who is 12, who attends the Norton Middle School, and my son Nicholas, who is 8, who attends the LGN Elementary School. They both have thrived in public schools with the care of the Norton teachers, becoming good people, good citizens, and loyal Norton Lancers. I've also been publicly school educated. Went on to Northeastern University and earned a degree in business and Curry College with an MBA. For the last 16 years, I've been in business development for both small and large companies, making them profitable and as well as creating jobs. In this time, I realized how important it is, the balance between workers and corporations. The two cannot survive without each other. It is my hope to bring this understanding to Beacon Hill if elected on November 8th. During my campaign, I've met a lot of people And I've talked to them, and they've asked me what my priorities are. And the first is education. Massachusetts has the best public schools in the country. It's important to protect and advocate for public schools and ensure that the resources they have to prepare our children for tomorrow. Second, working families. Currently, working families are feeling the tightening of belts of raising expenses and stagnant wages. It's important that we ensure that a fair day's work deserves a fair day's pay, and that families are not crippled by the rising cost of health care. Either senior citizens and families are not crippled by rising costs of health care. Finally, funding for mental health. Families in the area have basically looked at the opiate epidemic and in our area, and this area is a nonpartisan issue. We have to ensure that the resources for both treatment and counseling are there, and because they will make a difference. Because this is absolutely a situation we either pay for now or pay for later. During the debate, I'll talk about several issues and hopefully expand these thoughts and hopefully earn your vote for the November 8th election. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now, Representative Barrows, your opening statement.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Jay Barrows. I'm the state rep here in the 1st Bristol District. It's been an honor and a privilege to serve the community of Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough over the last many years. I would like to reintroduce myself. I'm a small business owner. My mother started an insurance agency back in 1977. We have an office located in Mansfield, and we also have an office newly opened in Foxborough. My three children, Caitlin, Colby, and Chris, all work for the family business and participate in many of the community activities that occur in all three towns. Very active in the Rotary Club, very active in the Downtown Business Association in both in Mansfield and Foxborough. And my son Christopher serves on the planning board here in Norton. Very proud of their efforts of community service and help to others. I've lived in Mansfield pretty much all my life. I had a 7-year hiatus when I moved to Houston, Texas, the job brought me to, and then to New Jersey, and then back home. My roots are deep in the community and also deep in Foxborough. My mother was originally born in Foxborough. We have many family and certainly a lot of friends down here in Norton. With my background, I have been assigned the task of being on the Healthcare Finance Committee the last number of years at the State House. I've also served on a number of commissions trying to study retirement costs, OPEB, for our many retired state and municipal and county employees to try to get a handle on some of those healthcare costs that are really killing our budget. Worked on some mass health commissions trying to understand better and make suggestions on how we could have a better delivery system on that. I've been a big supporter of our communities. My family started a group called Together We Can back in 1992, doing father-daughter dances and then mother-son dances to boot. We've done it for the last 25 years. I've served as chairman and currently sit on the board of directors of the Hockomock Y, which has over 30,000 members, having worked with a number of community members to open a YMCA in Mansfield and then turned it into a YMCA in Foxborough. So there's a lot of things that I've done prior to becoming state rep, but at the same time of being state rep, I continue to support those activities in our communities. And that's what this job is about, understanding the needs, understanding the hopes and dreams of many of our families in our three towns, and working with them, whether they're Democrat or whether they're Republican. It's not partisan to me. It's my door is always open, and we try to help in any way we can. It's not a litmus test to see what party affiliation somebody might be, but it's an opportunity to work and try to help people the best way that we can. So I look forward to the debate tonight. Again, to reintroduce myself to the community here in Norton, as well as Mansfield in Foxborough, and share some of those accomplishments that have taken place since I've been a state representative, and quite frankly, be sure to share with everyone those hopes and objectives that I have for the next term, if so elected. So I do appreciate your attention tonight, and we'll appreciate your vote on November 8th. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Now we'll just move to the questions, and since Mr. Toole went first on the opening statements, we'll let the first question start with Representative Barrows and then go to Mr. Toole. Gentlemen, what are the main issues that clearly separate you and your opponent in this race? What should cause voters to cast their ballot for you instead of your opponent? And Representative Barrows, we'll start with you.
Well, I'll just start with two words. The two words are experience matters. For the last 10 years, I have served in the legislature, and I hit the ground running. I think my sense of what needs to be done in our three communities in terms of continued economic development, in terms of continuing to support and advocate for the schools, to continue to advocate for small business, for our transportation system that is very, very important to these three towns, and to continue efforts which I led on regionalization. First is the regionalization of the sewer. The second is the regionalization of 911 dispatch. So I bring with me a lot of experience, as I said in my opening comment, as a past chair of the YMCA, the seeing our youth served in our communities is very, very important to me. As being the past president of the Chamber of Commerce, the connections, the contacts, the people that are in providing and risking and investing in our communities on a daily basis with their employees doing great work. Again, as I said before, the schools, we should be proud of our schools. They have done yeoman's work, Mansfield, Foxborough, and Norton, in working with our students. The achievement that these young people have is truly impressive. I know the superintendents, I know the teachers, I know the kids. And to watch them progress and grow is really, it's an honor to be their state representative as well. So I think the difference is experience. I really believe that experience does matter and that you just don't wake up one morning and decide that you want to be state rep. Someone should check one's community service, their commitment to community, and their activities and what they've done to help foster that environment of community. So that's what I see the differences are.
Okay, thank you, Representative Barrows. Mr. Toole, same question to you. What are the main issues that clearly separate you and your opponent in this race, and what should cause voters to cast their ballots for you instead of your opponent?
So my opponent talks about experience, and he's served on the legislature for 12 years. But if you use that theory, it would be a lifetime appointment. These would be lifetime appointments. And it would mean that no change could happen. You know, when we look at his voting record in regards to education, fully funding education, fully funding public safety, he's lacking in those areas. You know, we look at issues such as mental health, which is tied directly to issues such as the opiate epidemic that's hitting this area very heavily. That's one of the major issues that we have. Is I don't think my opponent has seen, basically talked to the people here that this is really affecting. And really, basically, is his when we look at funding and shortfalls on education, on issues in the environment, those are another issues, three big issues. So education, mental health, and the environment are issues where my opponent has kind of lacked and really is not kind of stepped up and led the shown the leadership necessary for the district. So one of my hopes is that we address some of those and try to really take, instead of just slashing it down by 1%, actually look at some of the budget and look at what areas we might be able to reallocate funds to really hit home the message of what we're going to do and achieve in those areas, such as, you know, Chapter 70 funding, you know, try to advocate for more funding with the formula, as well as environment, making sure that we're funding the departments that are protecting this beautiful area of Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough.
Thank you. Representative Barrows, a minute for rebuttal.
Well, Michael, just to bring you up to date, I was elected in 2006 and began serving in 2007, so it's 10 years, not 12, so don't give me any more credit than I deserve.
All right, okay? Fair enough.
Secondly, it sounds to me as though what you're talking about is raising taxes. Because we inherited in 2000 and 2014 about $1 billion structural deficit. So we had to make some tough decisions, and I applaud your comments about the environment. The League of Environmental Voters chose to endorse you, apparently, and chose me as one of the Dirty Dozen. And the way the scorecard works is that the number of bills you file for the environment, the number of things that you co-sponsor and so forth add up to a certain total. But there's no mention of the regional sewer system that was created with my leadership that put 1 million gallons of water back into the ground every day. 1 million gallons of water back into the ground every day to protect and serve the Canoe River Aquifer, which we all share, Mansfield, Foxborough, Norton, Easton, Sharon, and a number of other communities that abut it. And if you notice, this summer we had a drought to beat any in history. It was a historic drought. And we are all under very, very extreme water bans.
Another 15 seconds.
Okay. The Environmental League doesn't give you any credit for that, right? They don't give you any credit for hiring a climatologist as opposed to somebody to help with the opiate problem. So I've been on the Norton Opiate Addiction Task Force. In fact, yesterday I was at North Cottage with the staff of 35 people discussing what we can do to improve things, and we're working on it. But it doesn't happen overnight. You can't promise everything to everybody.
Right.
Thank you, Representative. Mr. Toole, 1 minute for rebuttal for you.
So my opponent talks, Representative Barrows talks about the budget. And obviously there are two ways. You can either raise taxes or cut programs. Well, the governor and the speaker have said raising taxes is off the table. It's important, though, that we're not cutting programs that are vital to many people in our community, such as children's mental health, not fully funding them, victims assistance, suicide prevention. These are areas that we talk about with the mental health that, are very, very important. It affects so many families and veterans that you're basically advocating for not fully funding them, which is very, very troubling and it's very dangerous. And Scott, you're absolutely right. I was endorsed by the Environmental League of Massachusetts because, there is more than just, the sewer plant was great, and as you kind of claim it, it was for economic development of Foxborough. I think secondary, you kind of woke up into the attention of the environment. There's more than just the sewer projects, and we have to look at the solar credits and everything as a large picture. So, thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. And now our next question, we will start with Mr. Toole. And leading right in, you guys are jumping my questions on me. So, Mr. Toole, Foxborough, Mansfield, and Norton are tied together by certain things. And, strangely enough, sewers are one of the most important of them. What can you tell us about how you plan to further the working of the new Tri-Town Sewer District, and how do you see it progressing in the future?
My opponent had mentioned, we basically have gotten special funding to expand the sewer project for the three towns. And I think it's very, very vital because that is going to allow us to have more economic growth within the whole region. It's, one of the things that we've talked about in the debate, actually we haven't spoken about, but one of the things that I want to talk about is, Democrats tend to be, people think that they're not pro-business. I've been in business for 16 years. And I think it's very, very important that we look at zoning projects within the different towns, the industrial development councils within each town, each of the towns, seeing how they can work together. And this is, Representative Barrows, my hat's off to him because the sewer project is a great project that will bring the three towns together and bring more business in there. It's part of the infrastructure plan. But we have to make sure if we're bringing businesses to the three towns, that we're not just basically bringing jobs in there. We have an unemployment rate within Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough, which averages about 4%, give or take. We have to make sure that we're bringing tax revenues to these towns. My opponent is known that there's never a TIF that he didn't like, okay? We have the pharmaceutical company coming in that's not gonna pay taxes for 7 years. And guess what? Norton needs tax revenues, a base of tax revenue now, not 7 years from now, and there are no guarantees that those companies are going to be there past the 7 years. And they're negotiating with the ice cream company down in the New England Ice Cream Company down in on Norton as well. We have to make sure that we're responsibly working with TIFs to bring tax revenues and projects like the sewer project, to bring business into the area.
Thank you, Mr. Toole. Representative Barrows, same question to you. Foxborough, Mansfield, and Norton are tied together by certain things, and strangely enough, sewers are one of the most important of them. What can you tell us about how you plan to further the working of the new Tri-Town Sewer District, new being a funny word there, but and how do you see it progressing in the future?
Well, I think you're seeing it right now. I think we're seeing it right now, right this instant. There isn't a corner in this district where you can go where there isn't something being repaired, fixed, or built. I look in Foxborough, we retained Schneider Electric. It was a tax increment financing deal to get them to stay. They spent $30 million. They've been in the community of Foxborough for 108 years, and they're staying. And they're hiring 500 people in the next year and a half to come work at that facility. Those people will bring with them their salaries. They'll bring with them their needs for housing, for food, cars, clothing, whatever it is. We're going to be able to provide them that. The project that we did on Route 140 for the New England ice cream, they're bringing 85 jobs with them. They're building in a state-of-the-art facility that will be paying taxes. We were getting nothing on it now. Annihilum wrote a check for $1.3 million for the building permit fees. $1.3 million on an empty parcel of land in the Norton Commerce Center. So I think with that, they're going to bring a couple hundred jobs. It's biotech manufacturing. It's going to allow us to continue the work with the Wheaton College Life Science Center to provide them with key employees, but not just scientists and biologists, but people that work the spectrum. The range of jobs that they're going to be creating are from people in maintenance and AC and HVAC, all the way up to a guy that is figuring out how to create the next cure for internal blood diseases. The list goes on and on and on. Covidian in Mansfield. Samsonite settling and siting their corporate headquarters here. So if you look with the sewer, it wasn't just about Foxborough, as you had mentioned. It was about all three towns to create additional capacity that both Norton didn't have zero. They didn't have a drop. Foxborough didn't have a drop, and Mansfield was almost out. So by that creation of another million gallons a day has allowed for those companies to, with confidence, site here, stay here, and grow here, and invest here. And without that, we would be stuck. And I spoke to a business consultant this morning that said we are one of the hottest areas going in not only Massachusetts, but in New England. So I'm very proud of my record. I'm proud of that regionalization work. It took 8 years to bring all the folks to the table and strike a deal, not only with the towns, but with the state as well and the federal government. We took Wheaton College, who joined the sewer system, a huge user with their own plant that was ineffective, and put that into a state-of-the-art facility. We didn't get any special funding. The special funding is coming from the taxpayer. The special funding was the fact that we were able to secure a 30-year bond at 0% for 62% of the project. That's the special part. But it's all coming from the ratepayer. All of us are going to pay that are on the sewer system in each of those three towns, pay for betterments, pay for expansions. So we're all paying for it. There was no federal money. There was no state money. We are paying for it, but it's at 0%, which makes a heck of a difference. But it gives the community a sense that we're going to be able to continue to develop economic opportunity amongst business and families that need sewer and that can't afford septic.
Thank you, Representative Barrows. Mr. Toole, 1 minute for rebuttal.
Yep. You know, Jay, you say this is the hottest area for economic growth. We're selling ourselves short, it sounds like. You know, if anything, I would think that you would know that 30 years of trickle-down economics doesn't work, and it's been proven it doesn't work. You know, if we push taxes off, and basically not bringing in revenue to these towns that are struggling to finance education and public safety, we need tax revenues now in these towns. And, you know, jobs are great. I'm glad that they're bringing jobs, and I support jobs all the time. However, we need tax revenues now. And we don't have a lot of those jobs. People are not going to be living in this town. They're going to be commuting into this town, and they're not paying the tax revenues within this town. The second thing that you mentioned was these improvements are going on to the users of the water. Okay, so basically, this is another tax that you passed on to the users of Norton, Mansfield, Foxborough.
15 seconds.
That basically, they're probably unaware of that their rates are going to be going up. You know, families are having a tough time making ends meet, and you know something, that did not help it at all.
Thank you. And Representative Barrows, 1 minute.
Well, the Romans had figured it out about a couple thousand years ago. I don't know what you do if you don't have a place to put your solid waste. So if you've got another idea on that, let me know. It would be of very much interest to me. Norton in 2006 had 11.1% of their tax collection was from commercial and industrial. This year it's up to 2.5. Foxborough, 17% in 2006. It's up to 22% now. Mansfield, 19.2, up to 23%. What it does is, if you look at Norton because of that low number of 12.5%, $210 is a corporate tax contribution for each person that lives in the community. You go up to Foxborough, it's 543. We have an opportunity with one of the most competitive tax rates in Massachusetts, stable single tax rate, to attract more people, more jobs, more businesses to help us grow. And again, if you know of a better way to treat solid waste, let me know, because I spent 8 years fighting to try to A, preserve the water that goes back into the ground, B, make it so it is affordable by expanding the use. You know, just simple economics. The more people in the pie, the bigger the pie, the lesser the expense per person. So I think it's been well thought out, and we've had great leadership within our communities. It wasn't just me. It was town managers. It was water and sewer commissioners. It was selectmen, finance committee members, all those people that you have to incorporate into a big plan, facilitate, learn, and go.
Thank you very much. We'll move now to our third question, and we'll start this one with Representative Barrows. Mr. Toole, as a Democrat, you would be in the overwhelming majority party in the House. Representative Barrows, you are a member of a pretty small minority party in the House. Mm-hmm. Can each of you tell us how you think your party designation affects your ability to perform your job if elected? We'll start with Representative Barrows.
Well, I don't think it affects mine at all, quite frankly. I think it's an enhancement. I'm one of 34 Republicans in the Commonwealth, in the House of Representatives. When I went in, I was one of 15. Today, having Charlie Baker as governor, one of the most popular governors in the United States, I'd love to tag onto him with the great work that he's doing. But however, with my colleagues in the House, we don't look at each other as Republican or Democrat. We look at each other as who's got a good idea and who can help sell it to 81 members of the chamber. I know as a white-haired guy, when I walk in, they go, that's Barrows, the Republican. But quite frankly, many of them are close friends. We serve on committees. We know our families. We celebrate. We commiserate. But we try to get things done in a way that is much different than Washington, D.C. Washington, D.C. is stagnant. Nothing changes. Nothing moves. There's no leadership. It's been horrifying. And I can't not say that about Massachusetts. We've been innovative. We've come up with some good solutions to some real challenging problems, addressing all the different things that we've done in this past session, many of which I supported. So I don't see it as a detriment. I don't see, if I were to be partisan, that one more Democrat's going to change anything. With 100 and how many there are, 36. One more is not going to really make a big difference in terms of a partisanship election or a partisanship vote. We need to work together, and it isn't about the D or the R, but we need to work together. And all too often, sometimes we do see the politics take place where the speaker's green light goes off, and some of the Republicans will back away from that and vote no, while all the Democrats fall in lockstep and vote yes. If it were that significant, or it is that significant, I'm just surprised that with all the issues that Mr. Toole spoken about, why the Democrats didn't increase funding for education to the extent that you call fully funded, or why they didn't do more for mental health in the last few years that I've been up there, why they didn't do anything about the opiate addiction problem that was on the horizon 3-4 years ago. So I look to continue to work with the governor and to continue to advocate for this district, this community of Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough. This is where I care the most about. This is where it matters, at least to me and to my constituents that I listen to every day.
Thank you, Representative. And Mr. Toole, again, as a Democrat, you would be in the overwhelming majority party of the House. Representative Barrows is a member of the extreme minority party. Can each of you, but extreme by means of numbers, not philosophy.
I get it.
Can each of you tell us how you think your party designation affects your ability to perform your job if elected?
I think Representative Barrows had said, I am actually running, and I am a person who votes his conscience, what's right for the district, his conscience, and on the issues. One of the things that we look at, when we look at Representative's voting record, we look at, he majority of time goes with the minority leadership. So he says that he's bipartisan, but he's lock, stock, and barrel voting on issues with the Republicans every time. And so he isn't as bipartisan as he would like to think he is. For myself, I really am committed to working on the issues and looking at taking the issues one at a time. And I believe when we look at this area, I don't believe Representative Barrows has worked with the other representatives down in the southern part of the Bristol County as well. He kind of stayed within this neck of the woods, and that's fine, obviously, because we have a district in Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough. But it really is working with the Speaker of the House, and I'd be working with the Speaker of the House to try to make sure that we have all the access to programs down here in the first Bristol district.
Thank you. Representative Barrows, any rebuttal?
Well, I'm surprised, perhaps you haven't met anybody yet that is down in this district, but the Bristol County delegation is one of the most united in the House of Representatives under the leadership of Pat Haddad out of Somerset. Alan Silver, you know, I can go through the whole list from here to New Bedford, Fall River. We do work together. We advocate together. We work with our sheriff. We work with our district attorney, Mr. Quinn, who's a Democrat, I guess. But we all work together to ensure that Bristol County is getting what is necessary from the Commonwealth, competing, unfortunately, sometimes with Suffolk and Essex, where those folks outnumber us, you know, 5-1. So we do spend a lot of time. And you know, it's nice to say, Michael, that you can work on these or take them one at a time. You can't take them one at a time. If you've ever followed one of the sessions, we usually take up 90% of our work in the last 2 days of session. So you have to be prepared. You have to go to hearings. You have to learn about multiple things. It's not a single focus thing. My energy, however, is spent first in the district. And then you can get global if you want. But this is where it matters, and this is where you're going to hear from people when they're upset with something that the state has done or they don't like the way you voted. You have to face them, and you have to tell them why.
Absolutely. Thank you. And Mr. Toole, rebuttal, right? I am in the order, yes. So yeah. 1 minute for rebuttal.
So my opponent talks about how he's pulling together and working with the DA's office, if you will, or the community colleges within the area or other legislators. But when you look at his voting record, it differs that. He's voted no on fully funding the district attorney's office in Bristol County. He's voted no on fully funding Bristol Community College. And community colleges are one of those areas that basically give people access to extend their secondary education. It's a great stepping tool that's affordable. And, you know, so when you look at that, how could you be partnering with them when you're not, when some of the departments you're voting no to fully fund, you're basically saying no, I don't believe in it. So I think you're being, I don't think you're out of touch of saying, well, I'm partnering with these people and services and departments, you know, we're coming together as a group. You know, some of your voting record doesn't show that. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you very much. And we'll go to the next question, and we'll start this one with Mr. Toole. Mr. Toole, education funding is generally a top priority in most Massachusetts communities. The general public perception is that the state mandates too many programs without funding them and should provide more educational aid. The standard position of people running for the legislature is to promise to try and get a fair share of aid for the district. Let's try and be a bit more specific than that. How do we go about providing adequate funding for education in this state? What will you try and urge that we do differently?
So, to understand the funding for public schools, you have to really understand the Chapter 70 funding. And there was a formula that was invented in 1993, and it's overseen by the Chapter 70 Review Committee. Right now, towns like, or cities like Attleboro receive 50-50 funding, 50% from the state, 50% from the city. Towns like Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough are a 70-30 mix, 30% from the state, 70% from the city for the towns. Unfortunately, the Chapter 70 funding isn't keeping pace with healthcare and special needs costs. And I think what's important is looking at the formulas, the Chapter 70 formulas, specifically on those two issues, where we know that they're talking about tweaking how healthcare and special needs funding is calculated within the Chapter 70's funds. And really addressing those issues, because those two issues, healthcare and special needs funding, special education funding, those seem to be draining more money from towns' budgets than anything else. And it's important that we're looking at the formula and trying to tweak it out. Right now, the legislature had passed a ballot question that the voters probably will see next year that will talk about a millionaire's tax that will basically allow the funding will go directly to education and transportation. And I think those are one of the things that we can look forward to possibly and leaving up to the voters to decide, is this what we need to invest in, our infrastructure and education to go forward? But it is going to be up to the people to decide that. And I think that's one of the solutions as we look forward and talking about the Chapter 70 formula, tweaking it to control the costs that seem to be higher than most.
Thank you, Mr. Toole. Mr. Barrows, same question. I won't go through the whole thing again, but let's try and be a bit specific. How do we go about providing adequate education adequate funding for education in this state, and what will you try and do and urge that we do differently?
Well, there was a recently released, after a couple of years study, a new foundation budget report that has been authored and distributed to all of us. It has a price tag of about $1 billion to right some of the wrongs that perhaps that formula, the mystery formula, I haven't met anybody yet that's figured it out. Maybe you're smart enough, Mike, to do it, but we can't seem to find who's got the keys to the black box. But the foundation budget, we've got a number of recommendations in there, and it needs to be phased in over time. One of the other issues that you brought up was the millionaire's tax. The millionaire's tax, if you read the question, it's a constitutional amendment that would raise taxes some 80% on those people at that level of a million or more in income. But it's a constitutional amendment, and all revenues raised go directly into the general fund. So that extra $1 billion that somebody has touted, or $2 billion or whatever, that you'd like to see dedicated to transportation and education, you might have to convince 81 members of the House, 21 of the Senate, and then the governor that your idea to spend it that way would be the wise and most prudent way to do it. And I doubt that you would be able to do that, because there isn't a program in Massachusetts that somebody doesn't get behind and say, let's let the state fund it. One of the things with our school districts in the three communities, they all hover around 50 to 55% in terms of what the spend of their total budget is. And they've held pretty steady. We've seen a drop in all three communities in enrollment. So as they continue to work to achieve their budget goals, you know, it's always funny, I hear the word fully fund. I think you've said it three or four times tonight. What does fully fund mean? If there isn't anyone that I've seen in government that wouldn't take the money if you gave it to them and figure out how to spend it. So we need to have some mile markers along the way. Healthcare is killing us. Why is healthcare killing us? Healthcare is killing us because of Obamacare. There's no question. We have the highest rates in the United States for health insurance. And we pay 75 to 80% of our healthcare costs for most of our municipal and state employees. It's a big, big number. We've seen those numbers continue to rise every single year, and a bigger increase is coming this year. My other question for you would be, in terms of education funding, which you've touted as one of your priorities, what would you cut? What would you cut out of a budget that you were presented with a $1 billion shortfall? The governor presented us with over $250 million of vetoes, and it was partisan. All the Democrats voted to override his vetoes, except for the 10% cut that he put in for his office. They all supported that. But we were trying to reduce costs by 1%.
15 seconds, please.
1%. And if your employer came to you and said, I got to cut your pay by 1%, would you quit? You'd probably figure out how to make it work. So that's what we've been required to do, and we did it without raising taxes, as you earlier had mentioned. The Speaker and the Governor said it's off the table. The Senate stands ready to raise taxes whenever it's presented.
Thank you, Representative Barrows. Mr. Toole, 1 minute for rebuttal.
So my opponent talks about the 1%. This isn't an Excel spreadsheet where you just take 1%. You need to make, what we're seeing when we're looking at the budget is we're basically going down there and you're basically voting no 1% on everything. You've got to look, and you've got to look at the programs that this affects. Mental health of children, you can't vote no on that. You can't vote, these are items that are already underfunded, and you're basically saying, no, already underfunded, no, I'm not going to fully fund it. In regards to the foundation budget, it's not a black box, it's not a mystery. You have to make the effort and you have to basically spend time understanding the formulas and how it affects the communities and what feeds into that. It's the size of the community, it's the medium income, it's all those items. And to call it a black box is just, something you're not taking the effort to learn about the foundation budget. And this is what feeds our public schools. It's wrong that you don't know that. In regards to the millionaire's tax, it is a constitution that it does not go into it. It's not earmarked right into the general budget. That money is earmarked for transportation and education. The underfunded, the other money obviously could be moved out. The budgeted money can be moved out, but the millionaire's tax is set constitutionally into that.
I disagree.
Representative Barrows, you're one.
Yeah, I mean, you're wrong. You're absolutely wrong, and to insinuate that you somehow know what you're talking about on that is absolutely false. It cannot be. It goes into the general fund, and then is determined by the House how it will be spent. So it isn't as easy as just. And then the other question I guess I would ask is, as a Commonwealth, for us to single out one group versus another as it relates to taxes, what will we do next? Where will the number go? I don't think it's going to go up. It's going to go down. So it might actually impact you someday, or me someday, or all of our friends in our district someday. So don't be so sure that it's going to be dedicated to anything that you or I might like to see it dedicated to. The foundation budget did that. That's what these people on this committee spent 2 years doing, reviewing exactly what Chapter 70 did. Chapter 70 has been in effect since 1993. I think we've had a number of Democrat governors and legislatures that have seen it and dealt with it. It hasn't been fixed. It was a bipartisan effort to work on that and pull it together. And now we have to find the $1 billion. But my last question is, what would you cut? What would you cut if somebody said, you don't have $1 billion out of $39 billion that you thought you did? What would you cut?
Thank you, Representative Barrows. And unfortunately, under the rules, you don't get to answer that right now, but you can feel free as we go
I'll
along.
Ask again.
And I compliment both candidates for having a great debate so far, but turning the question a little bit, we'll start this question, I believe, with Representative Barrows. This has been a tough year for campaigning on the national level. Many people are tired of all the negativity and the negative attacks. So let's turn it around here. Would each of you please tell me what you've come to like and respect the most about your opponent during this campaign? And we'll start with Representative Barrows.
His signs are everywhere. I especially like the one in, no, I won't say that. I think, Michael's got some pretty cute videos. He's using social media to the best he can. He probably, like me, is looking for likes all the time. As motivation to do this. Looks like he's got a nice family, a couple young kids who, I'm certainly in his camp. I've got four grandchildren, and it's fun raising them, fun watching them grow, but it's really cool when they go home. So you got a ways to go on that. But yeah, I mean, you know, God bless you. You're going to try to run for state rep, and, you know, good luck, and we'll keep it upbeat and above the fray.
Thank you, Representative Barrows. And Mr. Toole, same thing. It's been a rough year. How, you know, what do you have come to like and respect most about Representative Barrows during the campaign?
I could have been mistaken, but I think Representative Barrows called me cute. Maybe it was my videos, but maybe it was cute. But you know, I think this is probably one of the toughest things that I've ever done, and I can almost guarantee you that Representative Barrows would say that the same thing. Representing the people blindly is probably a very tough thing, and I have not done that yet, but he has. He is a dedicated public servant, but we do have different views on how to get the job done. And so, you know, his dedication to Norton, I have no doubt he's dedicated to Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough. And my hat's off for the 10 years of service that he has given and provided to the district. But we do have different ways of doing things. You know, when you knock on doors and they say, you're running against Jay Barrows. You know, and the feedback is, you get the feedback. So he has a name. He has a name for himself, and I would say that would be it.
Okay. Representative Barrows, any rebuttal on?
No, thank you. No, I mean, again, the national scene is a nightmare. It's embarrassing sometimes to watch it. I don't care whether you're a Republican or a Democrat. It does a disservice to the folks that we represent. You know, I've got some ideas, I've got some accomplishments, you've got some ideas, and you know, you're going to have to sell the voters of this district that your ideas are better than some of the accomplishments in the future that I see happen in our community. But it's important that we have the debate, and it's important to share those views, and it's important to get out and knock on doors and find out just how popular I really am.
Thank you. Mr. Toole, anything you want to rebut about popularity?
Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, something. Representative Barrows has, like I said, gone out there many times, probably knocking on doors. But, you know, something, the 10 years, we've seen him seem in office 10 years, and we do have different ways of doing it. And I think that message of education, advocating for more funding for education, advocating for working families in the district, and also mental health. Those are really the things that I'm passionate about, and it's resonating when I'm out there talking to people. And, you know, obviously Representative Barrows has his issues that he really wants to kind of wave the flag on. But this year is a tough year, and I think it's been very, I hope he feels the same way, but it's been very respectful. And, you know, one of the big things that we miss in this nation is the ability to disagree. You know, we have this forum where we may disagree on how to do it, but it's done civilly. And I think that's probably the most important thing during this campaign.
Okay, thank you very much. And the next question, we'll start with Mr. Toole, and enough of the nice stuff. We'll get back to the questions. Mr. Toole, where do you stand on the issue of expanding the cap on charter schools, which will be decided on the November 8th ballot with question two? Does funding charter schools under the current method create a small number of better schools at the expense of existing public schools? Or is it a benefit to more than just the small number who will attend those schools?
So, I mean, this is actually this question is pretty dear to me. It's, you know, raising the cap on charter schools. When charter schools were originally founded, they were supposed to be feeding our public schools and really feeding them ideas of teaching and methods and so forth. We've gotten so far away from that mission, from the current charter schools, that I think it's almost shameful. When a teacher from Mansfield calls the regional charter school and asks them to share their curriculum to try to improve the public schools, and they're told that it is copyrighted, this is public money, and those curriculums should be open and available. So when we talk about charter schools as a whole, I think charter schools have their place. We're blessed in this district. Norton, Mansfield, Foxborough have schools in the top 100. They're the best public schools in the state. And it's important that we're not diluting the public school funding by expanding every 12 schools a year and the population of each of the charter schools that can pick and choose which students they want, which basically adjusts, you know, if there's someone that has too much of a difficult education plan, they can put them back into the public schools. You know something, let's get back to what the original mission of the charter school was feeding innovative ideas to the public schools and not splinter the school system into two competitive school systems.
Thank you, Mr. Toole. Representative Barrows, same question to you. Where do you stand on the issue of expanding the cap on charter schools, which will be decided on the November 8th ballot? Does funding charter schools under the current method create a small number of better schools at the expense of the existing public schools, or is it a benefit to more than just the small number who will attend those schools?
Well, it's a tough question. Struggle a little bit with it. It was really a failure of the legislature to, you know, organize around and come up with a proposal that we could convince the governor of to pass and settle the question that way. Now it's gone to the ballot. There are some 33,000 kids in Boston that are on waiting lists to advance to a charter school if they're so lucky to be chosen in a lottery to gain access. Those kids are being denied every day their ability to get a better education or what they view, their parents view, as an opportunity for choice to break some of the curse. Our area, as Michael said, we do have great schools. We are blessed to have Foxborough, Mansfield, Norton, the Foxborough Regional Charter School, which has done great work with minority students in neighboring communities. Norton High School is now a choice school where folks come in from Attleboro and Taunton and bring with them their community funds, if you will, to participate in that high school. We're seeing that movement. But I think the charter schools from their inception have created an atmosphere of learning that has worked for them. It's certainly a longer school day. They have some advantages that parents look at, diversity being one in our three communities that the charter school offers. Different curriculum. But I have not heard of anyone ever calling for curriculum and being denied any discussion. I've heard it somewhat the other way, that there hasn't always been this united front of the acceptance of both, in that they were in taking care of the same kids, whether they live here or they live in Brockton or Taunton or Rainham or Plainville, we're taking care of those same kids. In terms of the money, the Boston Globe, which I don't believe much I read in that paper, not like the local Sun Chronicle, you know, they've written that it's a $400 million lie. The ballot question that is in your folder that most everyone has received by now. The teachers union, who spent $9 million to defeat the question, have said that we lose $400 million. Mass Taxpayers Foundation wrote that the public school system will see an increase of about $236 million in funding as a result of this. And when students leave, the money is left behind for a number of years to help fund the public school system so that they're not, you know, facing a cliff. So I think it has worked out. I think it's raised all boats. It certainly had an impact here in our three communities, again, working with the Foxborough Regional Charter people to try to meet the needs of those that want that choice. And I think that it shouldn't be determined by your zip code what choice you get, but it should be a statewide initiative that those folks that are in poor communities that we spend countless dollars on a system that is broken, that we need to allow them the choice and cheer them on and fund the appropriate numbers that we are trying to do and trying to leverage to make them obviously go up.
15 seconds.
But continue to do, you know, the good work that we've seen here in the first Bristol district, and proud of all four schools, all four of the school leaders, the superintendents. They all do a wonderful job, teachers, and the kids are pretty good too.
Thank you, Representative Barrows. Mr. Toole, any rebuttal?
So, Representative Barrows, I apologize. You can't do it both ways. You can't be statewide and then local, okay? This is gonna be a $4 million impact. The charter schools are a $4 million impact to Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough. How do we make up those shortfalls if we increase the number of schools that are in the area, increase the number of attendance, that will, so that $4 million will increase? Right now it's $4 million. You know, how do we create those shortfalls? The only way to do that is to raise taxes, I guess. So by voting yes on two, and you know something, I disagree with you, the ads campaign that's going on right now is paid for by billionaires. And it's been proven it's paid for by you billionaires. And they're basically, the no on, the yes on two vote is basically lying to the public people, saying there's no drain of money. And you know something, we need to make sure that we're protecting our district. And by increasing that, by voting yes on two, will hurt public schools in our district.
I will eat the teacher's apple if there is another charter school built in our district. It's not about here. We've achieved the goals of choice. We've achieved the goals, the grades, the lifting up of all boats. There's not going to be another charter school built here that our kids are going to flee
but
to.
They said they're going to increase the, right, they said they're going to increase the tuition.
Representative Barrows' enrollment.
The cap goes up, but it's really, you know, when I ran into my good friend in Boston, the legislator, and he said, this is all about the city. This is all about the city. The city of Boston, the city of Lowell, Lawrence, Springfield, Holyoke, Chicopee, Fall River, New Bedford. It's about those cities and those folks that are screaming for a choice. They want to be like us. They want to have that choice to educate their kids where they want them to go. Public schools are doing a good job. Charter schools are doing a good job in our district. No question. And I don't think anybody has a problem. And we're seeing a migration of students coming back to the public schools in our district. 30 going back into Mansfield schools because they're looking for a broader athletic program than what the charter school can offer.
15 seconds.
Kids come and go. My daughter went from second grade to seventh grade at the charter school. Came back, was ready to learn, settled in, graduated from Mansfield High School. So there's an ebb and flow in this. And the $9 million that has been being spent by the teachers union isn't a bunch of billionaires. It's a bunch of hardworking teachers that the union has said, this is what we're gonna do with your money to defeat it.
Okay, thank you, Representative Barrows. Our next question, we will start with Representative Barrows. Representative, we have an opiate epidemic raging through this area, this state, and this region. We have a lot of lives affected and a lot of people addicted. What will you do as a legislator to help address this problem? And in general, what can the legislature as a body do to try to address the problem?
Well, excuse me, we've tried to address it, number one, in some additional funding in this budget cycle to create some areas of treatment, certainly concentrating on areas of prevention. The bill also did some things to kind of take down the numbers of these opiate prescriptions that were being you know, authored and given to try to get some control of it that way. As I said earlier, I was at North Cottage yesterday where there were over 200 men from our area who are seeking treatment there, and they're there typically up to 6 months for their care. And it's a struggle. It is an absolute struggle, and my heart breaks for those families that call me and say, can you get my daughter, can you get my son a bed? Because there aren't enough of them. We just did this, you know, getting the thing rolling in the July fiscal year. You know, we had had some in, during the supplemental budgets in 2015, but to get this thing up and running. And I'm on the Norton Opiate Task Force with the district attorney out of Bristol County, as well as Brian Clark, Chief Clark, as well as many, many other dedicated people, staff at Sturdy Memorial Hospital. I've gotten an eye-opener, and yesterday was another one, learning what these folks are going through. So it's a real challenge. I think it's good that we've recognized that we have this problem. All too long it had been kind of shoo-shooed, you know, in the back of the building or around the alley, and it's affecting our entire population, our entire economic demographic. It doesn't have a target. It can get anybody. And I worry about our young kids, our young athletes, but the conflicts, some of the conflicts that I have, you know, we under Obamacare, now we rate the quality of service by hospitals and by doctors. And one of the things, the top five vital signs, is how much pain are you in, right? And so the consumer gets to choose between 1 and 10, 10 being the highest, and is then expecting the doctor to provide them some means of success in eliminating the pain. And I think it's unrealistic. So you've got competing interests that are trying to rate the quality of care and being dinged by their payment if they don't solve the pain problem. You've got a drug called Vivitrol that is an absolute antidote that a patient can receive once a month, and it blocks the receptors in the brain from being affected by the results of opiate or opiate-like symptoms, which is can cause death. The Vivitrol is $1,200 a month, and I hear people say, "Oh, that's so much." Well, what does an ambulance ride cost? What does a 24 hours, 48 hours cost in the hospital setting? So I wonder sometimes what we are trying to accomplish, because the Vivitrol should be given at any opportunity that we have to convince a person after detox to use this faithfully until they pass their craving and can beat back the addiction.
Thank you, Representative Barrows. Mr. Toole, same question to you. We have an opiate epidemic in this area, in this region, in this state. What would you do as a legislator to try and specifically address the problem? What can the legislature do as a body to address the problem?
So, as I said, one of the main focus is mental health for families and veterans. This epidemic is clearly hitting families. It's nothing like we've seen before. You know, we used to have a very small number of overdoses per month. Now we're seeing it at about 190, and it's getting more and more out of control than what we see per the state. You know, I basically do applaud the governor and basically stepping up for additional bed funding, but we also need, bed funding is enough. We also need to match it with the counseling to go along with it. If we basically, what you're doing is you're fixing the part of, you know, if you had your car broken, you're only fixing part of the car. We need to basically have the beds to treat these individuals and then do follow it up with the counseling. And that's one of the toughest things. And I'm glad that Representative Barrows is on the task force, because this really is a nonpartisan issue. It is, I think we would both agree on that. This is something that if we don't address it, this is the first time we've seen a drug epidemic like this that we've thrown some money to and we're not seeing it slow down at all. And we really have to address it, and we have to tackle it as a society. And one of the things that I do really take a little bit offense for, this drug that basically stops the transmitters and so forth, is we have to make sure that we're not being held hostage by some of the drug companies. And if there's something that the state can do, even though we're forbidden to negotiate values of drugs, we should try to work with them to make sure that these are available to the citizens of the Commonwealth.
Thank you. Representative Barrows, any rebuttal on that?
No, I mean, again, I think with the learning, what we can do in learning more with the opiate task force here in town, we had a meeting a couple of weeks ago, where we're just trying to collect data. They're really trying to use risk assessments for students in the opiate legislation that was passed. We're going to be spending some time with our kids in fifth grade, Michael's kids' ages, to understand what risks could be coming out of that family. We're asking the teachers to do more, the administrators to do more. We're asking health analysis or health risk assessment be done for anybody that has been brought to the emergency room as a result of an overdose. We've equipped our police and fire first responders with Narcan to save those folks. We've allowed the sale of Narcan over the counter in all the drug stores here in the Commonwealth, so that parents that are struggling as much as their kids can have a life-saving tool to save them and hopefully get them into treatment.
15 seconds.
We've got the STEP program going on down in Taunton that was expanded, and from what I understand is doing really, really good work. So you can't turn this thing around in a day. You can't turn around in 6 months. It's going to take a year. It's going to take 2 years, 3 years, but we'll get there.
Mr. Toole, any rebuttal?
I think Representative Barrows is right. It takes a village to kind of tackle these problems. I've had a close friend who is affected by this, and he's created a program called No First Time, and it's really addressing the stopping of drugs for children right at the fifth grade level. That basically it's about decisions and stopping them from taking drugs right at the beginning, and I think that's important. I think it's also important that we really monitor the amount of pills that are being issued for pain meds. Even though there have been regs, we have to make sure that those regulations are enforced. It's going to take many efforts. It's going to take law enforcement. It's going to take firefighters. It's going to take local leaders to address this and solve this problem. And an honest discussion with family members. And I think that's one of the things that I hope that the task force is looking to do, is to basically remove the stigmatism of addiction and move so we can basically, hopefully, end this epidemic.
Thank you. And now we're going to go to, despite your pleadings, otherwise this will be the final question before we go to closing statements, and we'll begin this question with Mr. Toole. Let's sort of take the other side of the question that we just had. There are probably easily 100 liquor licenses in the district. You can buy a drink just about anywhere. You can go to the supermarket and buy a bottle of wine. And on the ballot coming up, we will have a question on pot. Yep. And whether people over 21 can use it recreationally. That's going to be decided on the ballot, but the rules and regulations would probably have to be settled by the House. So the question is twofold. Are you in favor of question four? And secondly, if question four passes, what will you concentrate on in building regulations as a legislator? And we start that one with Mr. Toole.
So I believe that the question four, I would have loved to have seen the legislature take this on first and not put it to the ballot. Because if you look at the legislation itself, it favors the marijuana industry greatly. Okay, and more so than if it was just an item of pleasure or item of sin, it basically does favor them. I do support question four because I think it is important that we move into regulation. We move into regulation, we can tax it as well as make it safer to ensure safety for children. Where I do take offense to it is if you look at the other states around the country. Right now, the proposed excise tax on marijuana is approximately about 9%. If you look at places like Washington, Colorado, Oregon, it's in the range of 37%. And while we're going down a risky road, and I believe that the voters want this, I do believe that there should be a certain amount of tax revenue that comes along with that. So I do support it for regulation so we can regulate it, make it safer, and move it out of the black market where it is right now.
Thank you. Still, Representative Barrow, same question to you.
Absolutely not.
Could you be a little clearer?
No.
No. Okay.
You didn't sway me with your article a couple of weeks ago. Absolutely not. You know, we just talked about this horrible epidemic crisis with opiates. And some kids didn't sprain their ankle or twist their knee that started taking them. Some kids used marijuana as a gateway drug. This bill, or this ballot question, I'm sorry, was written by and for the marijuana industry. No question. That's where it came from. It allows the sale of candies, cookies, gummy bears, soda, that will be all available and not regulated. It allows an individual to grow marijuana on their property, in their home, next door to whatever they live at, whether you as a neighbor or a community like it or not. And it allows them, I don't know how much marijuana you can smoke, but from what I understand, one plant will generate a pound or something. That equals on the street value $7,000 a plant. And you can have 12 of them in the state if this ballot question were to pass. And people can sell it to their next door neighbor, or maybe to the kids down the street. Or maybe they won't know, like the kids take the booze out of the locked liquor cabinet now, but maybe they'll take a few leaves off of the growing tree in the backyard and sell it to their friends. Absolutely absurd. And then when I hear, no disrespect, you say, well, geez, we got to get more tax out of this if I'm for this, you know, because Colorado gets 29%, Washington 37%, Alaska and Oregon 25%. It's crazy. That money is not going to cover one iota of first responders, fatalities on our highway, bodily injuries on our highway, Washington State, the fatality rate on highways has doubled in 1 year from drug driving. The family, we lost a state police officer on the Mass Pike, was hit by a medical marijuana user. 6 kids, gone. And now we're gonna just say, hey, everybody have a party, have some fun. There's no regulation in there who's gonna maintain it, who's gonna count it. You know, when you buy a bottle of Kettle One vodka, you know that that's what it is. The ABC has done all their regulation and so on and so forth. We haven't even got the medical marijuana thing right yet, and it's been 4 years. We're still trying. So absolutely not. And if you care about kids, and you care about community, and you care about the village, you'll vote no.
Thank you, Representative. And Mr. Toole, any one-minute rebuttal?
It's almost comical that you believe that marijuana is a gateway drug. It really is. And this is actually kind of taking me by surprise because in committee, you said you were going to take a libertarian view on this and legalize it. So you may have done more education and kind of changed your opinion on it, but you in committee, in the health care committee, you had said this, okay? But it's been decriminalized by the voters several years ago. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if you have less than an ounce, you get a citation. Okay, so people are using it as it is, and they're basically have less than an ounce. So I think you're saying, well, oh no, if we don't pass this question four, you know, something, it will disappear. It's not disappearing. Okay, and you know, when we look at THC, there are many uses for it. You know, from hemp to so forth. But more importantly, it's, you know, the law is written that it's basically the legalization of marijuana for over 21.
15 seconds.
And so it is going to be controlled. And you know something? Realistically, it's not up to you and I. It's up to the voters. You want to take this choice, basically. It sounds like you would rather take this choice away from the voters. I believe voters should have the right to decide what is legal and what isn't illegal. And I surrender my time, yield my time.
Thank you. And Representative Barrows, last rebuttal.
Well, I mean, just one, I take issue that I ever said I was a libertarian and I was in committee. I'd have to see where you got that one from. So share that with me sometime.
Sure.
I started back in 2008. I had my daughter, one of my daughter's best friends, was murdered in Mansfield selling a bag of pot down on off of Stearns Avenue. Nice neighborhood. Shot in the head, killed. Had a full ride to UNH. And so when we got the news and we thought it was time that we finally pulled our parents together that had acted before when our kids were little to say, this is ridiculous, what's going on? And we formed a tri-town drug and alcohol task force. And we met for many, many years and worked with the police, and we got back to the point where we got police back into our school systems. Service officers to work with our kids, and we've done risk assessments, and we've looked, and we keep seeing a spike, and we decriminalized marijuana, much to my chagrin, and we've seen a spike in teenage use. We saw a spike in teenage use out in Colorado. It's decriminalized. The baloney that's on the TV that's saying all these people are being arrested for use of pot, that is absolute garbage. They are not. It's decriminalized. Let it go on that way, but don't commercialize it, and don't let others profit by it and our society be ruined as a result of it, especially with an opiate crisis going on, an alcohol crisis going on with our kids. Enough already.
Thank you, Representative. And thank you both for answering the questions in such a professional and nice way. It was a very good job done by both of you. We will now move to our closing statements. And according to the coin flip familiar, our first closing statement will be from Mr. Toole.
My opponent tonight has talked a lot about experience matters at the state rep level. With this logic, we would have career politicians and change would never happen. So in my closing statements, I want to talk a little bit about my experience and my beliefs if elected to be your next state representative. As a businessman, I've used my creativity and ingenuity to make companies profitable while creating jobs. I understand the balance between responsible taxation versus investing in our district's future. We need to look at the budget strategically and approach and evaluating these 1% cuts across the board to try to reduce the budget. These are people, these programs affect people. And we have to ensure that if we're doing cuts within the budget, that we're basically looking at the programs, maybe decreasing some programs a little bit more, and maybe even increasing programs a little bit more. So it takes not just an Excel spreadsheet of a 1% deduction across the board. It takes a strategic look as a whole. In towns, in regards to, and you know something, and it's important that we're not just voting up along party lines in regards to these services. We have to make sure that we're not pushing TIFs, which are tax advantages for business, that puts a strap on a town's tax revenues for 7 years until they see a dime from companies coming into our region. Okay? Unemployment is very low here, and the jobs are great, but we need tax revenues in Norton, Mansfield, and Foxborough to expand our schools and to make this a place where people want to live. Advocating for, as I mentioned many times in the debate, I'm advocating for education, more funding for education, working family benefits, and mental health. I've basically used my 16 years within private sector, having leadership within business, and taking a fresh look at the issues on Beacon Hill. I will advocate for more funding and have a leadership role within the district. And if elected your state representative, a vote for me will be a vote for change within the district. And I hope to have your vote on November 8th. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Toole. And Representative Barrows, your closing statement.
Thank you. And thank you, Bill, for hosting this tonight. And thank you, Michael, for your respect and some of your positions. Some I agree, some I very admit that I don't agree at all. First off, our communities have benefited by the various tax increment financing deals that have been put together. And in fact, I don't know if you have any understanding of them, but you actually go to a town meeting?
I do.
And the town meeting is the ones, the voters are the ones, the participants are the ones that decide yay or nay. It's not the town manager or the state rep. It's the town meeting. That's the first bridge that you have to cross. And I've never seen a TIF in the town of Norton. I don't know if you've ever been to a town meeting before.
I have.
But they have not ever had one person. In fact, I didn't see you stand up and vote no. So, you know, now all of a sudden they're a bad thing. So if you participated, most of them go out, as the moderator would attest, unanimously. The second piece is our communities, by working together, have been able to accomplish a great deal. Whether it's the sewer, whether it's the 911 regional dispatch. I've read on some of your, as I called them earlier, cute videos, need to see a more synergy of our three communities. There hasn't been anybody any better at synergy than our three communities. Our Tri-Town Chamber has a regional economic development committee working with representatives of business in each of those three towns in coordinating with the efforts of the three industrial development committees that represent each of the three towns in the district. So we're already doing that. We have the support of the chamber. We have the support of the IDCs. We have the support of each of the three towns that had to vote in that sewer deal. It wasn't just me. And I apologize if it sounds like it was just me. It wasn't. It was elected water and sewer commissioners. It was selectmen who were elected. It was everybody, and then ratified by the community. What a great form of government. In terms of me wanting to go back, there's a bunch of more things that we want to get done. We want to get done with experience mattering improvements to the MBTA. It's embarrassing what our train station looks like in Mansfield that services Norton and Foxborough as well. We want to complete the bike trail that is going to run through Norton, that this community wants. and we're going to get $4.1 million of funding in 2018 to make that happen. We want to see the Route 140 study. You talk about synergy. You talk about bringing these communities together. We brought Southeastern Regional Planning District to the table with Mass Highway and said we need to create a corridor of safety, a corridor where our citizens can commute to and from work in a safe manner, and we need to make those improvements along that way. So there's a lot left to do. We got a $2.3 million MassWorks grant that is the first linchpin to creating a more accessible train station and less traffic confusion if you've ever been to Mansfield. Foxborough, we're working on a plan of traffic enhancement up at Forbes Boulevard across from the New Hampton Hotel that's going in. So I appreciate the efforts of many who have helped me, the bipartisanship. I didn't get any of this done without Senator Timmelty, who I think the last time I checked was a Democrat. Didn't get any of it done without help from the Republican leadership in the House. I didn't get any of it done without the help of the Speaker of the House. So to think that I only vote red or I only vote green when the leaders go off that way, somebody has to say no once in a while, Michael. Somebody has to make those tough decisions.
We need to wrap
up. I think when you, if you ever find out, it's not easy. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Representative Barrows. Thank you, Mr. Toole. And that will complete our debate for this evening. I would like to thank very much both of our outstanding candidates, Representative Jay Barrows and challenger Michael Toole, and wish them both good luck on November 8th. I would also like to thank Jason Benjamin and everyone at Norton Media Center for doing the real work and making this entire production possible. Without Norton Media, the voters would not have had this opportunity to hear directly from their candidates. Lastly, we remind everyone that Election Day is Tuesday, November 8th. The polls will be open until 8 p.m., and if you are unable to vote in person, you can obtain absentee ballots in advance from the town clerk's office in your town hall. Ladies and gentlemen, on November 8th, thousands of you will turn out to mainly vote for president, and that's very important. But I'm telling you that voting for your state representatives and your local people has more of a direct impact on your everyday life than who is running for president of the United States. And if you doubt that, the next time an asphalt plant tries to move into your neighborhood next door to you, try calling the White House and asking for help. And then call your state representative and see which one responds to you and which one is more responsive and helps you in your situation. Your government on all levels plays an important role in your life. It is your duty and your responsibility to take an active part in choosing the people who run it. If you don't vote, don't complain. From Norton Media Center, I'm Bill Gouveia. Thank you and happy voting.